The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Lord be with you. Holy God of compassion, you invite us into your way of forgiveness and peace. Lead us to love our enemies and transform our words and deeds to be like his, through whom we pray. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. You shall not defraud your neighbor. You shall not steal. And you shall not keep for yourself the wages of a laborer until morning. You shall not revile the deaf, or put a stumbling block before the blind. And you shall fear your God. I am the Lord. You shall not render an unjust judgment. You shall not be partial to the poor or defer to the great. With justice you shall judge your neighbor. You shall not go around as a slanderer among your people. And you shall not profit by the blood of your neighbor. I am the Lord. You shall not hate in your heart any one of your kin. You shall reprove your neighbor, or you will incur guilt yourself. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter. Jesus said to the disciples, "You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist an evildoer. But if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your coat, give your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go also the second mile. Give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. I would like to invite the children to come forward. Good morning. You know, one of my favorite songs when working with children, we're going to sing that song. And it goes like this. It first sounds like I'm bragging because it goes, I am special. In fact, repeat after me. I am special.
I am special.
I think you can do better than that. I am special.
It is true.
I know that God loves me. Loves you. Too. Isn't that a great song? It helps us know we're special. You all are special. Why? Because God loves you. All right? Don't ever forget that. God loves you. You belong to God. And then there's something else that's great about that song. It helps us realize all of our friends are special too. People in our family are special. Okay?
Pastor Dan, you know when Beto Don? I don't.
No, Melody, I don't. But we can talk about it later. Here we go. Let us pray. Repeat after me. Gracious God.
Gracious God.
Thank you. For making us special. For loving us. Help us to love you. Help us to love others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you can go back to your seats. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Luke's working on the PowerPoint, so let's see what happens. When you're going to preach your last official sermon, a lot of thoughts went through my mind. Should I become sentimental and tell about all kinds of stories, and I tend not to do that. But my ministry in life around the church happens to be about people, children. In fact, at chapel this week, I did chapel for the child care center, and at the end of chapel, by the way, I begin chapel every time I do it with that song, "I Am Special." At the end, I told the children I was retiring. I asked them if they knew that, what that meant. First, I told them, "I'm getting old, so I'm going to retire," and I asked them what that meant. And the little boy that keeps telling me, asking me the question, "Pastor Dan, why are you so old?" When I asked, "Do you know what it means to retire?" He says, "Yeah, you stop working and then you die." And I said, "Yes, but not that fast." Makes you wonder, doesn't it? What are the conversations that go on in that household? What are those parents telling that kid? Kids are great. People are great. And by the way, my sermon today is titled "Free to Be." I'm not working, though. They'll get it. We'll wait. So, children and people. And I've often, you all have faith stories to tell. And often I get the privilege, it's a sacred privilege, when people die, to tell their faith story. And sometimes at their funeral, I do a pretty good job and sometimes a terrible job. But at least I try to tell their faith story. And a faith story, let me give you an example. In fact, sometimes we don't know we have these faith stories within us until we get involved with Bible studies and things like that, and we go, "Oh boy, I feel that way too," and we start understanding how our faith works out in life. An example of a faith story comes from our 101-year-old. By the way, Vi Sims will be 100 this June. Vi was in church last night. She said she's coming to the dinner today. Our 101-year-old is Vega Islandria, and Vega told me this story a couple of times. Back when she lived in Lafayette, Indiana, it was a Sunday, early afternoon. She had already gone to church, and there's a knock on the door. She opens it up a little bit, and there's a man and a woman standing there. And she realizes it's not dangerous, so she opens it all the way and talks with them. And the man says, "Can my wife stay here while I go and find our car? We go to such and such a church." And Vega understood that that was a church that began in a storefront. They were still worshiping in a storefront. He had parked his car somewhere and couldn't find it. He was going to go find it. He went for a while. He invited the woman in. Vega invited the woman in. They had coffee and had conversation. The woman asked her what church she went to, and she said, "Well, I go to the Lutheran church." And the woman says, "Oh, my. You shouldn't go there." And Vega says, no, that's all right. I really like it there." And the man came back, still couldn't find his car. So Vega said, "Well, describe the place where you parked it." And he said, "Well, I remember it was by a big building." Well, the only big building they had in her neighborhood was the school. So Vega said, "Hey, hop in my car. I'll drive you around until you see your car." They drove up by the school, and sure enough, they saw it. She drives down this gravel road. It was parked along a gravel road on the side of the church, or on the side of the school. And they said, "Okay, you can stop your car here now." And there was still a little distance to their car. And they both opened the car doors and left without saying goodbye, thank you, or anything. They left the car doors open. They got down to their car, got inside. Vega said, well, thank you, and walked around, shut the doors, and got back in her car, and she thought, well, I better wait to see if they can get started and get on their way, and she did, and they got on their way. She went home, didn't think anything of it until a couple of days later she receives a card in the mail from somebody she didn't know. She opened it, pulls out the card, and it says, don't you know, you're going to hell. And it was from the couple that she helped. And she thought, was my coffee that bad? Here's the point. I'm actually having this lead up to our text. Let's back up. Too often, we have been criticized as Christians, not Lutherans in particular, but Christians, especially by millennials, for having a one-dimensional faith. All we think about is, supposedly, the criticism goes, who's going to hell and who's going to heaven? It's as if there was a big wall. Remember, heaven has a gate and a wall. Big gate and wall around heaven. And extreme vetting. So millennials criticize us for this one-dimensional theology, personal salvation, worried about the afterlife. And here's where we come into Martin Luther's discovery and how we're free to be. What does it mean that God saves you? God in Jesus Christ saved us from the condemnation of sin so that the eternal fate of our souls is in heaven instead of in hell. I don't know if you quite got that from my 20 years with you, but our salvation, our citizenship with God is in heaven. And it's not because of anything we've done. God has freely, for the sake of Christ, forgiven us, redeemed us, and claimed us as his own. So we don't need to worry about what's going to happen to me when I die. You belong to God. And you're being held in God's strong embrace as you live. And certainly, you will be held by God's strong embrace when you die. Jesus says in our text, be perfect as our Father in heaven is perfect. Your perfection in God's eyes is given to you as a free gift. You are perfect, not because you're living such a perfect life, but because God in Christ declares you sinless, perfect. Now I know we're going to leave here, and through the week, we're going to lead very imperfect lives. But you come back, you see, next week, and hear those words that God claims you as his own, that he forgives you for the sake of Christ. It's a free gift. Forgiveness, Jesus gives us, gives that to us. So do you have that? You now, all that worry about heaven and hell is taken care of. We're to live our lives now by God's grace. So that question, and I don't know how often I hear it from people, oh, we're just trying to get to the same place, aren't we? No, we're already there. It's a free gift. We're free now. Here's where free to be comes in. We're free now to work on the other two dimensions of our faith. Dominic Crisan gives us three dimensions of faith. First one, personal. It's a free gift given to us by God. The next two fall under that petition in the Lord's Prayer, "Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven." God's kingdom. So now we're working for God's kingdom. You're all giving me that stunned look like they did last night after I finished my sermon. What did that man say? The other dimensions of our faith are all about living out "Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven." Those people who study our brains, study the evolutionary process and what we gained as we evolved into what we now call Homo sapiens. And they say we still struggle with the reptilian part of our brain. That has given us fight or flight. Fight. And all the violence that we see in our lives and in our world all comes from that reptilian part. Jesus is inviting the crowds. He's inviting us to consider embracing a life that in many ways counters our very basic instincts for survival. He now tells us, when somebody wants you to carry their pack for a mile, go 2 miles. When someone slaps you on the right cheek, turn the left one also. Love your enemy. It goes against our basic instincts. Love your enemies. Go the extra mile. Give up your rights. Almost sounds un-American, doesn't it? Three dimensions of faith. We talked about the first one. Remember that you are a child of God. The socio-political transformation. Martin Luther King Jr. is an example of this. And isn't it amazing that Martin Luther King Jr. even embraced Jesus' love of enemies? He said, "We can never get this done without loving our enemies and being non-violent." The third one, spiritually. Living one's life plugged in to the love of God. Let's talk about the second dimension, socio-political. Let me give you just a simple example. At Rotary this week, we saw Julie Higgins. Anybody ever have a cookie called Julie's Chewies? Anybody? Okay. She started Julie's Chewies cookies, and a very successful businesswoman before that, and made a lot of money. So now she's free to go around and help people. And she believes, she's a devout Christian, believes that even the poorest, most dissolute, most disenfranchised people in the world, if given a chance, can succeed and have their lives flourish. By the way, the ELCA has been doing this forever, at least since I've been in the ministry, working with indigenous peoples. What I like about what Julie Higgins did, she went to Addis, Ethiopia, and found a community of people that was segregated from the rest of society, and she wanted to help them, the lowest of the low. They were separated from everybody else in Addis, Ethiopia, by a pile of garbage that was 10 stories high. I don't know how many miles long, But people in Addis did not know this community of lepers, of people with HIV/AIDS, of people with tuberculosis. They didn't know 150,000 people lived in this community. Julie Higgins was told she could help 10 women. So she took 10 of these women, helped talk to them about empowering their lives, and then gave them business loans to start businesses. Each one of them thrived. And she said they especially thrived when we could transport them into Addis itself and in the business district, sell their wares. One woman had scarves and she sold her whole inventory in one day. So it's quite an amazing story. What is she trying to do? She understands that second dimension, that we're told to work on socio-political transformation of those who are the poorest. Third dimension, the spiritual dimension, living one's life plugged into the love of God. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said this, by the way. By your enemies, talking about Jesus' words here, by your enemies, Jesus means those who are quite intractable and utterly unresponsive to your love. But love asks nothing in return, but seeks those who need it. And who needs our love more than those who are consumed with hatred and utterly devoid of love? Then he continues, the love of our enemies takes us along the way of the cross and into fellowship with the crucified. Douglas Hare, in his commentary on this text, says, this is all about renouncing our rights. Someone wrongs me. My natural response, my reptilian response, is to hate them. Jesus says, love them. Now I could go on for another page giving you quotes from famous people, but we're going to end with this story. It comes from CBS News, and maybe you saw it on CBS News. It's a story of a young man, Jamil McGee. In his own words, he says, one day I was minding my own business. I was approached by a police officer who roughed me up, hauled me into jail, and accused me of having drugs and selling drugs. He planted the drugs on me. I was convicted. I spent 4 years in prison. I lost everything. The only reason Jamil got out of prison early was that the police officer was caught falsifying evidence, and he went to jail. When Jamil got out, he said his only thought was trying to find that police officer and hurting him. Well, sure enough, wouldn't you know, as an ex-con, he couldn't get a job, so he got a job in a Christian coffee house. They were employing ex-cons. And wouldn't you know, who should he find working there too, is the police officer, who only spent a year and a half in jail compared to his 4 years. He said, all I want to do is hurt him. So I went up to him, and the police officer said, I have no excuse. Jamil, a Christian, immediately forgave him. Did he have the right to be forgiven? No. Did he have the right to get beat up? A reptilian part would say yes. as they worked together over the weeks and months. Jamil came up to the police officer and said, I love you. I want you to know I love you. And the police officer said this, I just started weeping because he doesn't owe me that. I don't deserve that. It so moved the CBS reporter that he said this, if these two guys from the coffee shop can set aside their bitter grounds, I hope he intended that as a pun. He said, if they can set aside their bitter grounds, what's your excuse? Well, Jesus says, you belong to me. You are perfect, as the Heavenly Father is perfect, because that's a gift from me. And now, work on the other two dimensions of your life. Build God's kingdom. Love. You're free to do that now. Free to be. Amen.
Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe. Called to be a light to the nations, let us pray for God's justice, peace, and healing. Gracious God, we thank you for pastors and other leaders who are the master builders, building on the foundation that is Jesus Christ. We know you are still sending faithful builders.
But most especially, we are thankful for you, O God, for you are building a living temple for your Holy Spirit out of the church. May we be grateful servants, reconciled before you, working together as your holy building. Lord, in your mercy.
We pray for clean air, clean water, and clean soil.
Renew the sky, land, and waterways. Teach us how to care for the earth as you desire. Lord, in your mercy.
We pray for an end to war and for peace throughout the world.
We remember especially Kashmir and India, where 8 were killed in fierce fighting, and for the innocent being killed in northern Syria, and for the people of Lahore, Pakistan, after a suicide bomber killed 13. At the same time, we pray for our soldiers as they work for peace. Prosper the work of peacemakers, erase hatred, and stop violence. Lord, in your mercy.
God, our healer, we pray that you restore the forgotten and heal the hurting.
We remember especially Jane Alward, Henry Bremenkamp, Ralph Everett, Kingston Gilbert, Mary Hall, David Harkey, Debbie Huff, Ivy Ruth Johnson, Helen Monsees, Willie Moraski, Ruth Pipcorn, Pat Roper, Jan Snaff, Terry Shanks, Pat Chicaney, Brian Wogan, Kim Roll, and Marietta Young. Are there any others?
We give thanks for the faithful departed.
Comfort those who mourn, especially the family and friends of Luann Craig, Doug Skinner, Ron Boggs, John Overan, and Sandra Riedel. Hold them in your loving embrace. Lord, in your mercy. Receive these prayers in the name of Christ, the light of the world, who is one with you and the Holy Spirit now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
merciful God, receive the
gifts we bring, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Through this meal, unite us as your body, shining with the light of your justice and mercy. For the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All is ready. Our Lord invites us. Please come. You may be seated.
Thank you.
the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
The servant depart in heavenly peace.
Morning star, fair and bright, you have refreshed us again with heavenly food. You are our dearest treasure. Go with us now, today, tomorrow, every day, that we tell the story of your never-ending love and sing your praise both now and forever.
I'm going to suggest that you read your messenger. Next week, we still have some room in the van, the shuttle, for going in the afternoon to coal camp for the Ministry Area 8 Ministerium, where the bishop comes and meets with everyone. And don't forget, next week, the bishop will be here as the preacher. I will be here probably to assist the bishop, but he will come and preach.
And just to clarify, because we've had a couple of different times posted, but for any that are joining us for the celebration for Pastor Dan and Nick and the dinner, that starts at 12:15, or as soon as he lets the next service out.
Well, if I preach like I did today, there might it's going to be maybe a quarter to one. The other thing is, Ash Wednesday, we will have worship. That's the first. It's my official first day of retirement, but I'll be with you. We're going to have a noon worship service and a 7 o'clock worship service. After that, under the able direction of David Seward, there will be Lenten worship, and you're going to have skits that are appropriate to Lent on those at those services. David has a stack of material like this. He has enough material. If it doesn't get done, Janine. All right, receive this benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Guided by the gospel, we welcome all to worship, make disciples, hunger for ministry, nurture youth, gather resources for growing ministries, and offer healing and care to all in need. Go in peace, remember the poor.